You want to be able to attack with a state machine, and you want to do so while idling, running, or jumping, but you don't want to create a new state for each of these conditions. That's a lot of wants, but in this video, we're going to solve this problem without having to create new states with duplicate code. Howdy, and welcome to Game Endeavor. Learn practical dev skills and improve the quality of your games by subscribing and ding-a-linging that bell. Soon after learning about state machines, you will encounter the problem that I just described. A very common mistake when trying to implement this, developers will create an idle attack state, a running attack state, a jumping attack state, and so on. In doing this, what you'll notice is that you're just duplicating the logic for each of these states, and then duct taping the attack logic onto them. My biggest pet peeve as a developer is duplicate code. It is difficult to maintain, a potential festering nest of bugs waiting to burst forth from the literal depths of the darkest abyss that you could imagine to control your entire code base to make your life a living hell. So let's see what we can do to fix that. A solution to this is what's known as a concurrent state machine. This is where multiple state machines coexist with each other, playing nicely and existing in harmony. For example, you may have one state machine that handles the core of your character's logic, such as if they're idling, running, or jumping. And then you have another state machine that handles other actions, such as if they're attacking or using a tool. For this tutorial, Paul Bearer has a simple state machine. I made a quick video on how to create a simple state machine if you want to watch it to get caught up. However, this concept will work with whatever state machine you happen to have lying around. This state machine is able to idle, walk, jump, fall, and chew bubblegum. Due to the nature of state machines, however, Paul Bearer is unable to walk and chew gum at the same time. Our goal is to fix this, but not to allow him to chew gum while jumping because he values his life. If you're trying to implement an attack system, then this is the exact same concept, it just goes by a different name. Let's go ahead and get started. As stated, a concurrent state machine is just two state machines that coexist with each other. So we'll start off by creating a new state machine. I'm going to call this one Action State Machine because I'm just the best at naming things. Create a script for it that inherits the base state machine that we created in the state machine tutorial. In the ready method, we'll initialize two states named None and Chew Gum. None is the state for when the player isn't doing anything. Again, just the best. And then we'll make a deferred call that will set the state for this machine to None. Quickly, I'm going to handle the animations for the state. If you've watched the video on implementing the state machine, then this will be straightforward. All I'm doing is having the player's animation player play an animation based on what the state we just entered. For this demonstration, I'm using a concurrent animation player that will play alongside the main animation player. If you're using one animation player with two state machines, then you'll need to check the state of the other state machine to determine which animation to play. Now we'll create the transitions for the states. We'll start with a match statement so that we only process the transitional logic for each state. If the state is none, then we want to try and transition to the chew gum state, which we'll do if input.isActionPressed chew gum, which I have defined in my project settings. This will make it so that we chew gum whenever the key is pressed. However, we don't want to do so if the player is jumping or falling. So we're going to create a method for this named canChewGum, which will return a boolean. I'm going to stash the states of the parent state machine into a variable named mainStates for easy referencing. Then we're going to say return not an array holding the values of mainStates.jump, mainStates.fall, .has parent.stateMachine.state, which will return true if the player is not jumping or falling, otherwise it will return false. We'll then add this method onto the condition we were working on earlier. And if this condition is true, then we want to return the state for chewing gum. We also want to transition out of the chewing gum state if the player releases the key. So we'll say states.chewGum to see if we're currently chewing gum. Then we want to check if not input.isActionPressed chewGum, meaning that the player is no longer holding the key, then return states.none. This is fine and dandy, but Paul Bearer is still at risk of choking if he jumps while chewing gum. We want to take him out of the chewing gum state whenever the main state machine enters the jump state or the fall state. You have a choice here how you can handle this. Either you can prevent jumping in the main state if the player is chewing gum, or you can stop chewing gum here if the player is jumping. We're going to do the latter. We're going to reuse the canChewGum method we just created by adding the condition or not canChewGum to the condition of the chewing gum state. And that's all you need to fix that. However, this only fixes simple issues. For more complex ones, you may need to swap out animation rather than changing states. If that is the case, then you may want to implement signals for detecting when the other state machine changes states, so that you can act upon them here and change your animations accordingly. If you want to continue learning practical dev skills, then watch this video on creating a wall slide using the state machine. And if you're new, then join the sub club to get notified for future videos.